All right, I'm gonna hope that you guys cannot hear my boyfriend and son playing downstairs because they're kind of loud when they play. But today we are gonna be talking about myths that have to do with abortion and basically debunking more pro-life arguments. So, yeah. Each year, about half of all pregnancies among American women are unintended. And half of those unintended pregnancies usually end in abortion. And this rate has gone down exponentially over the years. Every year we see less abortions, as well as less unintended pregnancies and less babies being born overall. We have a generation that really doesn't want kids, or at least doesn't want kids in a home that, one, does not contain two parents, and two, that is not financially capable of raising another human being. And I feel like a lot of our generation as well is focusing a lot on self-healing, a lot of the trauma that we have been put through, whether it be by society or by our parents themselves. And wanting to make sure that we are the best parents possible for the future generation. So, the incidence of abortion can be tracked in two different ways. The first is simply to keep a tally of the total abortions obtained by women who fall into specific categories. Numbers tracked in this way are usually expressed as a percentage of all abortions provided in a year. And alternatively, the rate of abortion can be measured by calculating the total number of abortions obtained per 1,000 women who make up the total population in each category. So, if we're looking at age, women between the age 15 and 19 account for about 19% of all abortions. Women 20 to 24 account for about 33%, and then for 30 and older, it's about 25. And abortion rates are usually the highest among older teen and young adults, and then obviously younger kids and those over the age of 35 are usually lower. And I'm guessing that this is because both groups of those people are less likely to probably get pregnant in the first place. So, when it comes to abortion, when we're looking at the length of pregnancies, before when we were looking at statistics, it was about 88% of abortions were obtained before the first trimester. And this number has actually gone up to 92% of all pregnancies that end in abortion are terminated in the first trimester before 13 weeks. In fact, over half of all abortions are obtained within the first 8 weeks. And fewer than 2%, which I believe it was 1.2, occur at 21 weeks or later. It's extremely rare for a woman to have an abortion after viability. And this is usually done because either, we see a child with very unfortunate abnormalities, and or the woman is going to die from carrying out the pregnancy, or both the woman and fetus will die from carrying out the pregnancies. And women who obtain abortions, looking statistically wise, are usually single. I believe it was 83% are unmarried, and then I think 77 or 67% have never been married. And obviously the number decreases significantly if the woman has been married because they're less likely to have an unintended pregnancy. When we're looking at religion, women who obtain abortions represent every religious affiliation, obviously. 13, I really hope you guys cannot hear them. I don't know if you can hear them or not. I can't hear in my microphone with my headphones on, but I can definitely hear them. But women getting abortions, I believe it's 13% of abortion patients describes themselves as born again or evangelical evangelical. I'm thinking of my daughter's name, but evangelical Christians, while 22% of U.S. women are Catholic, and 27% of abortion patients say they are Catholic. So jumping into the myths, one of the first myths is that women are using abortion as a form of birth control. And right off the bat, I could tell you that that argument doesn't make sense, and that even if it did happen, that it'd be probably unlikely to be a common practice, meaning like almost all women are doing this. Like, I would say it's probably like one person out of like 100,000 people. So before I even actually researched this and decided to debunk this myth, I can already tell you that it wasn't like a likely thing. So in fact, half of all women getting abortions report that contraceptives were being used during the month they became pregnant. Some of these couples had used the method improperly. Some had forgotten or neglected to use it on the particular occasion they conceived. And some had used a contraceptive that failed. No contraceptive method prevents pregnancy 100% of the time. That is a given. And on top of it, if abortion were used as a primary method of birth control, a typical woman would have at least 2 or 3 pregnancies per year. And that'd be 30 or more during her lifetime. And most women who have had an abortion had no previous abortion, which is about, I think it was 52 to 56% of all women only had or had no previous abortion. And then 26% had one previous abortion. And considering that most women are fertile for over 30 years and that birth control is not perfect, the likelihood of having 1 or 2 unintended pregnancies is very high anyways. And again, I could see these number decreasing in the next episode that we're going to go over what we can do to actually reduce all of these numbers overall, whether it be unintended pregnancy, abortion rates, etc., etc. The other myth that I wanted to talk about was that women have abortions for selfish and frivolous reasons, meaning for like no reason at all, or, you know, just to be selfish. So the decision to have an abortion is it's not simple. I wouldn't imagine it to be. Most women base their decisions on several factors, the most common being a lack of money and readiness. That's why abortion is usually done by women below the poverty line, and we actually see Black women having abortion at a disproportionate rate to white women because more Black women are subjected to poverty in the first place. Many of them just are not ready to expand their families due to existing responsibilities. Many feel that the most responsible course of action is to wait until their situation is more suited to childbearing. 66% of people that obtain an abortion have a plan to have children when they are older, financially able to provide necessities for that child, and are in a supportive relationship with a partner, so their children have two parents, like I stated earlier. Others wanted to get pregnant but developed serious medical problems and learned that the fetus had severe abnormalities or experienced some other personal crisis. And about 13,000 women each year have abortions because they have become pregnant as a result of rape or incest. Women are often forced into having abortions they don't really want is another topic that I wanted to talk about. A lot of people, mainly in the church community, I feel, say this very often, that they could save these women. If they could just talk to them, they could save them and basically convince them to keep the child without actually providing any sort of actual help other than words. I believe the organization called Love Life, I believe it is, stationed in North Carolina, I believe, has been harassing an abortion center, And that's one of the things that they do is they kind of stand outside of the abortion clinic and try to, quote, coax women into coming over to their van. And if they are successful, one of the situations that had happened on camera was they took a woman that couldn't speak English and they lied to her, told her that the abortion clinic was actually in their Love Life van and did not allow her to go into the center. And then once they kind of get on this van, they set an appointment that is a week or two out. And by the time they've already gotten onto the van, set the appointment, and they decide that they're going to go to this appointment, if they decide not to keep the child still, by then it's pretty much too late. They're past the time frame to be able to get an abortion, and now that option is now off the table. And I don't believe that it's a good thing. I don't think people should be convincing people whether or not to get one. And I do know whether or not people are actually being forced. So some women say that pressure from a husband or partner or parent was one of the reasons that they chose abortion, but only about 1% give that reason as the most important one in making their decision, meaning that, okay, I got an abortion because if I didn't, my husband, my partner, whoever in my family made me feel disgusting about it, or they forced me, or whatever, I had no other choice. Most of them give more reasons as to why they want the abortion in the first place. And some women who do not want to continue their pregnancies are pressured to do so by family members, friends, or fear of social stigma. In pre-abortion options, counseling is designed to determine whether a woman is fully comfortable with her abortion decision. And if she is not, she is encouraged to wait until she has had a chance to consider her options more fully. So if anything, basically, the majority of women that say that they felt pressure, which is 1%, into getting an abortion, that's only 1%. And the real truth is the majority of people are actually trying to pressure women to keep the child. That is usually what happened. That is mostly what happens. Not that they are being forced to have these abortions, but rather they are being told and forced into keeping the child in the first place. And it's just absolutely crazy that we just don't allow women to just make whatever decision that they want. I feel like when it comes to something like that, I feel like you can weigh in without saying a decision. You may explain their situation and tell them what options that they have and kind of leave it at that. But I wouldn't say that anyone should be trying to sway somebody to either keep or abort a pregnancy. I feel like it is a difficult decision regardless. And I don't feel like anybody really needs to chime in unless, of course, you are the father and you obviously have some right in saying what is going to happen. So the last myth that I kind of wanted to go over was that many women come to regret their abortions later on. And research indicates that there is relief in getting an abortion, and it's actually the most common emotional response following an abortion. The psychological distress appears to be greatest before rather than after an abortion. And there are undoubtedly some women who, in hindsight, wish that they had made different choices, and the majority would prefer to have never become pregnant when the circumstances were not right for them. When a wanted pregnancy is ended for medical reasons, for example, women may experience a severe sense of loss and grief, as with any major change or decision involving loss. sometimes this leads to a temporary resurfacing of sad feelings surrounding the abortion, and women at risk for poor post-abortion adjustment are those who do not get the support that they need and whose abortion decisions are actively opposed by people who are important to them. So most people do not regret getting an abortion, rather than it's mainly women who actually wanted the child and had to get an abortion for unfortunate reasons. Abortion is not a walk in a park, in a park. It's not something fun that women want to do. It's not on anyone's bucket list. This isn't something that I feel is done senselessly. I'm sure everybody probably may or may not know someone with an abortion, but that has had an abortion. But I can tell you that throughout my entire life, and I've been on this earth for about 24 years now, I've only ever known two people. Yeah, I believe two people in my whole life that has ever actually had an abortion. And I can tell you right now that these reasons that I've stated are the exact reasons that they've given. They weren't easy decisions. They have still talked about it to this day. And it was a hard choice to make. And I don't feel like anybody should be judged for that. And I feel like it should be an option. It is absolutely necessary, especially in this day and age. And I believe that forced pregnancy and forced birth is a crime against humanity. And I think it's absolutely crazy that we have places like Ireland and Mexico that get it. And we have women from our country traveling to Mexico so that they can seek this medical procedure. And we have the United States, supposedly the greatest country in the world, that is trying to take that right away from women. This is the conclusion of the myths episode. I'm sure there was more out there, but obviously this would be an extremely long episode if we went over every last thing that people say about abortion and their crazy ideologies on it. So yeah, next episode we're going to be talking about what is going to actually lower abortion rates and what we can actually do to hope to reduce those numbers. So yeah, I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye.
Welcome to Controversial Conversations with Crystal. That's me and Desi, where we present facts, stories, and experiences and more to you in three parts, and then do our best to answer one big question in the final part. This is part three of the Roe v. Wade topic, and today we're going to quickly discuss myths and facts surrounding abortion. In part four, we will be answering the question, how can we lower abortion rates without banning abortion? Once more, I do not have I'm sitting here staring at my studio mic, my audio box, and it's not hooked up, and so this might be a little too loud. You can turn it down. It might be a little muddled in some wait, what's the sound of like someone has a pillow over your face? Muffled? I think that's the word. I don't know why that word sounds so dirty. It might not be the right word. But anyway, the sound quality is not going to be amazing. But I am hoping that Amazon has the XLR adapter that I need for that. Otherwise, I have to wait till like August or September to get my tech kit. So anyway, I just wanted to acknowledge the fact that I may be louder in some spots, and I may be quiet in some spots, and I may sound like I am swimming underwater in other parts. It is a new phone, it is very sensitive, it has a sensitive microphone, but I'm just making do with what I have. I don't know where any of my lapels are, so we're just going for it. Since we mostly offer facts based on research, I'm just going to rapid fire these 10 myths and facts. I will save my unasked for opinion for the end if I feel so inclined to give it to you. When it comes to myths about abortion, trust and believe that you've been fed a few. from being shown horrific videos in high school to media publications not based in science, but rather theology, if you are not educated deeply on the subject, then you are speaking only from opinion. And everybody has an opinion, unfortunately. If you want me to believe that your opinion is valid, you have to also be willing to believe that mine is valid as well. See how that works? What's the word? Reciprocity? Is that something? I feel like that's fractions. Moving on. Number one, adoption is better than abortion. Some people don't want to be pregnant, and you're all missing that part. Like, there's 9 months between pregnancy or beginning of pregnancy to the end, right? Some people don't want that middle part. Someone else's infertility problems in an overpopulated world is quite frankly not my problem. Many people also don't want to spend almost a year pregnant again just to give a child up the second that it's born. And not many people have support systems to go through with an adoption and sometimes can deal with severe depression, postpartum unaliving, or pressure from the other person to relinquish rights of the child, leading to domestic violence ending in death. Number two, people only use abortion for birth control. And this is probably the most widely believed myth. Most people getting abortions used contraception that failed, or contraception might be impossible for them to use. Also, sexual activity is not always consensual, nor is it predictable. Violent relationships or control can also make using contraceptives virtually impossible, leading to forced pregnancy and forced birth. Again, though, the majority of people who seek an abortion or have to have one were using contraception at the time. Saying that sex should be only, like, performed when someone intends to have a child is a weird fucking thing to say, quite honestly. Sex is fun, and most of us do it. Also, access to free and fair sexual health education plays a large part in reproductive health care later on in life. Number three. People get abortions just because they are lazy. The reality is, even if that were the majority, it's still not your business. Or is it your concern? Are you going to take care of that child when this lazy, quote unquote, parent gives birth? Probably not. Are you paying tax dollars towards that child's care without complaining? No. Forcing someone to live a lifestyle based on one decision that they made is the exact opposite of the freedom promised to us in the Constitution. People have an abortion for plenty of reasons, none of which are your concern, and to say that a woman can only have one if she has been assaulted is saying that a woman needs to give up the right to her body before she can have any rights to that same body. Number three, people have abortions all the way up until birth. So this was actually a very common thing, not a thing that they did, but a common myth in Florida, that they were just like birthing whole babies and just leaving them on the roofs of the hospital. I don't know if people remember that. It's not legal. Like, it's not something a doctor can perform, and it simply doesn't happen. A medically necessary abortion performed beyond 23 weeks is just that. It is medically necessary. I said this in part three. To say that you would give birth to a sick or a dying fetus, even if it only lived for a short period of time, I've seen people say this. People who not only know my personal experience, but people who have never lived through that are saying stuff like that. It's selfish. It's selfish as fuck. You would subject a being to pain and torture to satisfy you. Again, I said this in part two, it cannot feel or understand love. It will only understand pain, suffering, and eventually nothingness. In fact, it isn't around until like 2 or 3 years old that a child will understand love and trust. You are essentially saying, if I saw a dying animal on the side of the road, I would sit and watch it struggle because it's so cute and it's alive right now, so why would I put it out of its misery when I can just sit with it and watch it? You're fucking weird, and you're selfish, and you have no concept whatsoever. Whatsoever. If you've never lived it, you don't get to speak. That's that. Anyway, moving on, number four. And again, sometimes we get saucy, especially on like a topic like this that is very personal and very controversial, hence the name. It's It is, you either want to listen or you don't. If you are listening and you genuinely know me from the internet, then you probably know what's coming. So no, I'm not going to censor myself. Number four, if someone is irresponsible, they deserve to pay for that. First of all, what? You're saying that sex should be like a thing somebody only does to procreate. Once again, we are mammals, we have needs, and we have sex. And sometimes it's with strangers, and sometimes it's planned. We are at a point where we no longer need procreation to protect our species, and in fact, we need less of it to protect our planet and our resources and our species. And again, sex is not always consensual. Your belief that sex is bad is not rooted in anything theological or even scientific. Number five, just put your baby up for adoption if you don't want it. So again, this sort of like piggybacks off number one, I believe. Despite the fact that the U.S. foster system is completely hanging on by a thread, adoption is not an easy choice to make. And pregnancy is more dangerous than a first trimester abortion. And the psychological maladies of pregnancy can last for years. Subjecting people to emotional and physical pain and suffering is in itself not pro-life. We have to collectively. I want you to pause this, and I want you to go find the nearest pro-life advocate or whatever you want to call them. And I want us, okay, did you pause it? Are we talking? Great. What does pro-life mean? What does it mean? Pro-quality of life? Pro-life except for if they are a harlot and got pregnant? Pro-life until they're born? What does it mean to you? And the fact that pro-life means so many different things to so many different people should tell you automatically what side of the fence you should be on. It makes no logical sense to be pro-life. Some people deserve to die. I said it. Some people deserve to die. There are people out there who have hurt and killed children and women and men and transgender individuals and people just because they exist. There are people out there that have killed people just for existing. And there are horrible people out there. Are you going to look at me as someone who's pro-life and tell me that Ted Bundy didn't deserve to die? Some people deserve to die. And you cannot be pro-life and have the sentiment, because if you are pro-life, what does that mean? What does that mean? Pedophiles deserve to live. Rapists deserve to live. Murderers deserve to live. All those people deserve not only to live, but a quality of life that exceeds shit. So real quick, get in your brain. Don't fight with me. Don't argue. But I want you to find a pro-lifer. I want you to ask them what being pro-life means to them. Because if you ask someone who's pro-choice, it means that that individual gets to make that choice. Some people who are pro-choice even understand the concept of bodily autonomy. Right? So I have friends that are pro-choice, but for themselves, they're not going to do that. They would never have an abortion unless medically necessary, but they understand and recognize the right for another individual, another pregnant person to be able to choose. Why? With all the things going on in the world, why is not everybody like that? So again, if you can argue with me that Osama fucking bin Laden deserved to live and have a good quality of life, because you cannot say you're pro-life and then say that he deserved what he got. He did. Abso-fucking-lutely he did. Or, I don't, is that the one that died? He's dead, right? Yeah, whatever. We're getting off topic here, but I just want to know. I want to know so badly what pro-life means. Does pro-life mean everybody gets to live and everybody has a high quality of life? Or even a mediocre quality. What does it mean? Okay. Number six. Killing an unborn child is wrong. And this is where science class, like basic in-school biology, comes in handy. So during the first trimester, it is an embryo that will potentially become a fetus in the second month. It is not viable. It has no face, no autonomy, no feeling, no nervous system. It feels nothing if an abortion were to be performed at this time, and many women across the world can lose a pregnancy at this stage and not even notice. A being with no body cannot and should not have bodily autonomy over a fully functioning human being who has a complete body. Even your wanted babies, even your precious little skin sacks of joy, started out as embryos that had the potential to either turn into a fetus or to not. And then, you know, they go through this cycle and they become fetuses and babies and then toddlers and then teenagers and so on and so forth. There is no scientific, medical, or theological evidence to suggest that abortion is wrong. Number 7. Pro-choice means pro-abortion. Wrong. I kind of just touched on this. The name is literally choice, right? The word choice is in the name of the thing to be. Meaning that if someone, in fact, was faced with that choice, they should have the ability to make one for themselves and their personal situation. This means people can abort, adopt, or choose to parent. Whichever they choose should be supported or ignored, since again, you don't know every pregnant person in the nation right now and their decisions. But you all on this one side seem to think that you do. And then it brings up the conversation of, well, you know, women go out and they have abortions when the man wants the baby. That is very rare. That's just the same as saying only 1% of abortions are performed because of rape. That statistic is wrong, by the way. It's a little higher than that, and I'll maybe tell you more about that later on. It's very rare that a woman who is seeking an abortion is doing so, and the man is like, please don't, no, blah. That concept actually comes, I mean, that's happened, yes, for sure. But on this wide media scale of which everyone talks about this scenario, it was a staged event that happened with pro-lifers. It was a woman who was pregnant and she was a forced birther. I'm not calling you pro-life until I understand what it means to you, please. You're a forced birther. So it was a forced birther who was pregnant and her husband or whatever was pretending to be a man who was like, please don't do it. No, don't go in there. And it was fake. It was fake. Of course it was fake. So, yeah, I mean, has that happened? Absolutely. But that's a them problem. That's not a you problem. Right? Like, that has nothing to do with you. And sometimes the men are, like, all for it. Like, they're like, go do it, and the woman doesn't want to. Which, again, that is a them problem. That is a those two people problem. That is not a you and your freaking mom and your brother and your cousin and your auntie's goldfish problem. So, anyway, number 8, it is God's will, and abortion is wrong in the eyes of the Lord. Yes, a child, a literal child in Ohio was raped and ended up pregnant recently, and they were told it's God's will. Abso-fucking-lutely not. God killed a bunch of babies. Like, a lot. There was a lot of dead babies in the Bible. I don't know what version some of you read. You can actually still find as close to original text as you can get, albeit not complete, because, you know, time, fires, nations being taken over, all these fun, wonderful things that have happened since fucking 3 AD. Oops, sorry about that sound. Yeah, there was definitely lots of child death and death just because. So yeah, let's keep that in mind. Just immediately know. So as someone who practices Christianity and also understands the idea and the concept of separation of church and state, I'm going to kindly tell you to shut up. Also, the Bible says nothing about abortion at all whatsoever. So your idea is rooted in culture and not religion. The most widely used verse actually concerning abortions are like, what the fuck are they? Like Jeremiah 1:5, Psalm 139, 13 through 16. Neither of those actually discuss personhood though. And in Exodus, possibly, maybe. I probably should have wrote this down, but I didn't know I was going to go on a tangent. 21, verse 22 through 25-ish. Is where it talks about, like, what happens if a man injures a woman and then it results in the loss of a fetus. if that happens, if these individuals are fighting, arguing, pushing each other off mountains, and the fetus dies, the man has to pay a fine. You know where else a man has to pay a fine in the Bible? If he steals or kills somebody's animal, fucking donkey, camel, horse, giraffe, whatever they fucking had, right? So in that sense, a fetus is equatable to property and or an animal that is property. Correct? We can agree that that is a thing that it says. If you need a minute to go dust off your fucking goddamn King James Version, whatever the fuck you have, go ahead and do that. But we can agree that's what it says. Because it goes on to say that if the woman herself is injured or killed, that's when the eye for an eye, life for life concept comes into play. Not before then. So this is like based on the Hebrew version of this passage. It wasn't actually until the Greek translation that it clarified that it refers to any harm of a child born fully formed. And this was most likely like intentionally mistranslated in keeping with Aristotle's concept that abortion should only be done early on. Like, Jesus also didn't really say shit about abortion or even about like unborn children. You know, he wasn't like he was like fulfilling prophecies and shit. Like, he wasn't like worrying about stupid shit like that. Cause quite frankly, it's stupid shit. And just the history, like the entire context of it all, is there's this very sort of toxic positivity that falls into religion, particularly Christianity. And we are doing a deep dive on like the Great Schism, which is like a thing that happened. Like, you know how like you're like, I'm Episcopalian and you're a Baptist and you're something else. That's from the Great Schism, which is something we're going to get into. Why this is important to this conversation, because a lot of people are using religion to back this overturning thing of Roe v. Wade. There's no foundation. Any translations, especially translations for like homosexual marriage, like that didn't exist until like recently in the grand scheme of life. Each time there was a translation, each time a new language was, you know, obviously a translated for Christianity to spread, they were able to make changes in the sense of they were translating, quote unquote, incorrectly, I'll add that, and it would fit whatever like the highest, most respected person at the time in that region, in that culture, was saying. So again, it reflected Aristotle's concept of abortion should only be performed early on, which is why there was a translation within that concept. Are we following? Okay, moving on. Number 9. Now abortion rates are going to drop. Abortion rates have dropped, actually, since the early 1980s, and they have been dropping pretty steadily since then. Nothing to add there. Number 10, we care about life. I already went into a little tangent here, but I'm going to do it again, because this one is just a bonus for myself. If you truly cared about life, especially the life of a child, why do you shut down universal health care? You don't try to change it, right? Like, tweak it a little bit to make it better. Because, yeah, maybe the concept of universal health care maybe doesn't make sense on paper as it is. But you're just like, no. Never. Why do you shut that down? There are 16.2 million children in the United States that struggle with hunger every single year. There are 424,000 children currently in the foster care system. 10.5 million children were considered poor in 2019, with 71% of those children being children of color. So this means that about 1 in 6 children are born into poverty each year. 1.5 million kids in public school were homeless in 2017 and 2018. Recipients of SNAP or food assistance and benefits still suffer with food insecurity. Most families only average about $118 per person for the month, which is less than $4 a day. 4.4 million children under 19 are uninsured. Childcare costs more than tuition in 28 states for college. 20,445 children in the foster care system age out, growing up and going into the world with no family, no structure, no support system, and no goddamn idea what to do. The leading cause of death for children is actually not abortion, it is gun violence. For kids aged 1 to 19. So do you care about them? Do you care about any of them? You don't. Because the same people, and you can sit here and say you do, because when you're called out and asked about, do you care about these children that are dying in schools? Do you care about these children that are starving? Every stupid-ass comment that you make about, oh, she needs to get off food stamps. When you see a woman in the store using an EBT card, you're not attacking her. You're attacking her children, who have just as much a right to eat as your weird fucking kids. And that's why this pisses me off so much. None of you care about food insecurity. None of you care about the quality of life, because the ability to live is not alone enough to make up for a poor quality of life. A child that you care so much about that you think that it should live, should not be born into a family where it has to claw its way out of poverty. And I see the 4 or 5, 6 of you that say, well, I came from nothing and here I am. Good for you. Genuinely, congratulations. That is rare. Because in a system designed to keep people down, in a system designed to incarcerate children before their 15th birthday, on average, in the United States, that's not common. So these 10.5 million children that were considered poor, 1.6 children born into poverty, maybe 1 in 4 of them will get out, right? What about the other 3? What about them? The other 2, let's just say they go and fucking commit crimes and end up in prison. What about those 3? So again, you cannot care about life. You cannot be pro-life without considering these things and without also talking about them. And simply saying, well, the mother should just go work is not fucking good enough. It's not. It's really not. Lastly, we're going to talk about statistics on abortion, because now I'm getting heated. So the statistics on abortion that you see now are inaccurate, and the ones that I've put in here also are. States are not required to send their information on abortions to the CDC, nor are they required to send them to Guttmacher. And it's because of this that any statistics I highlight here in this video and any that you post on your little blue app are not accurate or reflective of actual statistics. Many procedures can be charged or billed as something that they're not. For example, a medical abortion will still count as an abortion, a DNC, or a medical loss. And again, a DNC will still bill as an abortion in some states. Also, rape, with that, because that's a big topic of conversation, that only 1%, it's much higher than that. And I actually, way back in high school, for an English debate that we were having, in a paper that I wrote, I had actually called different centers and had asked about that. And they also brought up the same conversation about nothing is really accurate. A lot of rapes go unreported, especially if it's like intermarital rape. Family, incest, and stuff like that. Those typically aren't reported because of threats, because of violence, because that person might not be able to get out of that situation, and therefore they're not going to go in and say, I was raped, and now I need to, you know, have an abortion. In 2019, which is the most recent information released, it was super funny. Some little girl on the internet was like, and yeah, she's a little girl, she's a child. Not really. I think she was like older than me, but she's, you know, irrelevant. And that's mean, but I never said I was nice. I just said I'm fact-based, right? Let's remember that. So anyway, I posted a thing and said, this is not accurate. Here's the most recent statistics. And I said 2019. And she said, oh, do you live in 2019? No, actually. I would much prefer to never revisit or stay in 2019 or 2020, for that matter. But with the way that things are released, we get things typically 1 to 1 year to 2 years behind when it comes to national statistics, because people have to go and get this information, sometimes individually, if you live in like a census state, And then they compile it all with thousands and thousands of different people, and then they put it all together. And with COVID being the way that it was and the attention going there, things aren't really updated. So in 2019, again, the most recent information that I could find released that was reputable, there were 630,000 abortions performed. 630,000. But in that same year, 672,000 children entered foster care. More children entered foster care than were, I guess, fetuses aborted in 2019. 1,840 children were killed due to abuse or neglect in that same year. Pregnant people between the ages of 20 to 24 are more likely to have an abortion than any other age group. And I know, statistics and facts are, you know, just meaning number things, and they don't mean anything to people with a pro-life forced birth opinion. And that's honestly not fine. It's really not fine. Your beliefs do not dictate science, and that's just the truth of the matter. In part four, which is our final part in this, we're going to answer the question of how can we lower the abortion rates without banning abortion? Even though the rates have dropped significantly over the last several years, I feel like y'all want it to be zero without that actually being possible. So part four should be exciting. As usual, Desi is going to be up next, or she might be first. Sometimes we just switch it up depending on the order of things. But all important links are in the description. The Diamond Art Club affiliate link, if you order from them, we do get a little small kickback. It's a super fun activity that increases focus and attention to detail. I highly recommend it. Definitely start with something small if you've never done it before. If you want to buy us a coffee, send us a dollar. Click the link. It says buy me a coffee. And you get to choose our next topic that we talk about. Be featured if you want to. Or if you want us to shut up for an entire month, you can send us like $500. And we will shut up for the entire month. So there's that. And lastly, any important links that go more in depth or that were sourced for the content that I talked about in my particular section will also be in the description. So immediately go to part four. Thanks. Or don't.